Well, welcome to the Tour of Lombardy, the last round in the 1998 World Cup. In fact, the race is over and done with as far as the World Cup is concerned. Unless Bartoli falls off in a big heap and Van Bon wins, there's no doubt that the situation will stay as it is at the moment with Bartoli coming into this race, the overall leader on the World Cup, and I think he's going to romp out at the end of it too as well. So they're signing on this morning at Varese, 10:30 in the morning, the race going Varese-Bergamo. Pascal Richard's always been a very good competitor in this event, I think looking for a chance to show himself again. This man, Gianni Bugno, coming through, twice world champion, now retiring from the scene. It's going to be his last major race. And there, Lance Armstrong, disappointed by the two fourth place in the World Championship on top of the fourth place he had in the Tour of Spain. Claudio Chiappucci hidden by the start flag there in the yellow, shaking hands with the start, and off they gone away for the 253 kilometres of the race today. That's 158 miles. This is Gianni Bugno, who did that surprising and superb ride in the Tour of Spain to get a stage victory there. Also on the right of your screen in the red and blue, Maurizio Fondris, a previous world champion for the Cofidis team, riding out with the rest of the big teams ranged round about him. So as they went out this morning of Varese, they had an easy start for what's going to be a rather damp day as we pick up the race further down course. Here we are now then with the race out live on your screen, and a breakaway group, already three men away, and they went away after some 130 kilometres of racing, a group of 19 men, and the final split is on your screen now. That's Bogart at the back for the Rabobank team, the Dutch world champion, sorry, Dutch national champion. He's been twice national champion of Holland, trailing on now behind a very significant breakaway group, because in this group we have the reigning world champion, reigning for only 1 week, if reign's the right word, because he won it in Valkenburg just on Sunday a week ago, Oscar Kamerzin. In fact, it's less than a week, isn't it? Because here we are on Saturday, and it was on a Sunday he won it. So 6 days after he's won his rainbow jersey, here he is in second spot in this little group of breakaways. The man out at the front of this three-man group is Vladimir Belli of Festina. And the three of them had the lead last time we heard, somewhere at about a minute and a half. There on the top left-hand side of your screen is the way in which the race has taken them today. Off the left-hand side of Varese, going up towards the top of the screen, they did a little loop round, came back down through Como, alongside Lecce, round another big loop, and then right down in towards the finish. The trouble with those loops means that if somebody's having an awful pasting and feeling a bit tired, they soon retire and find a way back down into Milan or wherever the hotels are. Sad news for the followers of Lance Armstrong is that he has climbed off his bike on the last but one climb of the day. He'd had three or four bike changes. He'd had problems with his chain, and in the end, he just couldn't get back with that vital 19-man group that went away, and so he decided enough was enough, and he's on his way back now to his holidays out in America. I wonder what happens to the cat Chemo. Whoops, here we go, another one has fallen off. We get a slow motion replay of the casino rider. There's come an awful box of tricks there. I think that might have been Yerman, but I'll have to get confirmation of that. But he certainly went down with a bit of a bang. We're back then with the tail end of this group. In this little group at the moment, Marco Velo, Velotti of Italy, Garcia Casas of Spain, Zinchenko, the rider from the Vitalicio team. That's him in the red at the front at the moment. A couple of stage victories in the Tour of Spain has, I think, given him about more heart. He tried in the World Championship to bridge that gap when the final chips came down with 2.5 laps to go, and he's trying to get away now in the red. Also here's Serpolini, Markusberg of Switzerland. But this is our leading group. You can see with the autumn tints on the trees and the leaves on the side of the road why they call this race the race of the falling leaves, and falling two riders as we saw there with the casino rider coming a box of tricks on that sharp bend. Well, he's trying to do what he can to get back into this little group at the moment, the Polti rider. That's Velotti, struggling somewhat at the moment. Simone here of Continentale just bringing up the tail end of this little group. And Marco Velo just up in front of him for the Mercatone Uno team. And between the two, we've got this little group at the moment, Pascal Richard and Puccini. They've prized themselves away from that chase group, going after our leading threesome. So we've got three riders in the lead at the moment. Kamerzin, De Bogart and Belli being chased down by Richard and Puccini, and a chase group behind, including Simone, The struggling Velotti, Cipollini, Seberg, Zinchenko, Taffy, Marco Velo, Velotti, Rebellin is in there, Garcia Casas, and Celestino's trying to hang on for grim death, but I think he's struggling a bit at the moment. And here's Bartoli coming off the front. And there's Taffy on the right-hand side, drifting away. Can't hold the pace of this man, Bartoli, who must still be smarting under that problem he had last week in the World Championships, when he tried to go away to get up to Oscar Kamerzin and didn't quite make it, and had to be content with a bronze medal when he was out-sprinted for the second place by Peter van Petegem of Belgium, and also out of the frame was Lance Armstrong, and out the race too, he's gone home. And is Bartoli going to make it? Bartoli doesn't really need to bust the gut like this, because coming into this race today, the World Cup, the position was Marco Bartoli had 376 points and Van Bon had 190. So even if Van Bon won the race, that would give him 290, and Marco Bartoli didn't finish, Michael Bartoli didn't finish, he would have 376 against Van Bon's at 290. And Van Bon hasn't made it into any of these breaks at all, so that's it. Bartoli really is just going to ride in and doesn't need to bust the gut, really. But on the other hand, I suppose his pride would like to get him up there with his leading threesome. And he's trying now to get across and bridge the gap to Richard and Puccini, who are between this three here. That's the world champion, Kamerzin. That in the Festina colours is Belli. And the red, white and blue, that is the Rabobank rider, Michael Bogart. Further down the classification of the World Cup. Sorry about the picture problem, by the way. It isn't always easy. In fact, I'm glad that we've got enough chances. You see here, Taffy just getting tail off a little bit. He ran an amazing race in the World Championship the other week, and I think he'd still like to storm away and do a ride in this one, but we've got some way to go toward the finish. Probably around about another 35 kilometres into the finish. They're on this climb then of the one up from San Giovanni, up to the top of the Forcella. So we've just come out of San Giovanni Bianco, climbing up then toward the top of the climb, the Forcella di Bura. When they get over the top of that one, there'll be 33.3 kilometres to go in toward the finish, and it's all downhill. Now still again, these are the twosome. Puccini on the front now, and then Pascal Richard. Over the years, this particular race has suited Pascal Richard there, the Olympic champion. He's on his way, he's moving out from the casino team, and I think, I'll check my notes, I think he's off to join the Pulte squad next year. Certainly he's moving out from France. In fact, they said they couldn't afford to keep him on the books, and he hadn't done enough this year to justify his higher salary, so the Olympic champion will be on his bike. Pascal Richard, we just saw him there. He was third in 1994, and he was second in 1990, so he's a very experienced man at the race at the back end of the year, whereas these three here, with Kamerzin setting and ploughing a new lonely furrow, I suppose. Of them all, Vladimir Belli took the ninth spot last year in the race, so he knows his way around. But when I say that he knows his way around, the course changes each year. The one thing about the Giro di Lombardy, I don't think that it's ever been the same course for, well, they do it for 3 or 4 years, then they change it, and another year they change it. It's had different. Oh, Belli's gone then. The man who finished ninth last year, and this course is nearly the same as last year's, but not exactly. And we've had over the years a course which would often finish down in Milan, and in those days the big selection process would take over, would happen on a climb called the Madonna di Gazzello, and they went over that particular climb quite early in the race today, so it's not going to be the nutcracker it used to be. In fact, they went over there with some 50 kilometres, no, it's no, 80 kilometres racing. This morning they climbed it, started up on the climb quite early on today, and nothing to really blast the thing to pieces, so the climb then of the Madonna Gazzello has not been the sort of feature it used to be. And that was the course where when you go over the top of it, they have got at the top a chapel in which the cyclists over the years have donated their winning jerseys from the Tour of Italy, from the Tour de France and most major races, and they've all been signed and autographed, and it's really is the cyclist church. If you've ever heard that top of the climb, it's worth going in there and seeing the collection of jerseys and trophies and mementos of most of the world's great cyclists. So Kamerzin now very determined to show his rainbow jersey to the full. Can he hang on to the finish in Bergamo? on the climb up to the top of the Forcella di Bura, and you can see that now Bell is about to be overtaken by Pascal Richard on the front, who's got with him the rider in the blue colours, and that is Puccini. Pascal Richard driving on here, there he is now. In fact, I've doubly checked for you where he's going to. He's going to Molivetta next year, Molivetta, and the winner of this race in 1993, there on your screen, sorry about that breakup, second in 1990 and third in 1994. So Pascal Richard is a very gutsy character this time of the year, but the revelation again is this man Oscar Kamerzin and Michael Bogaert here, both those two champions of the road in the World Championships just on Sunday week. One has to fear and feel for Bogaert, because when this man took off, when they were going, 8 kilometres from the finish of the World Championship, Bogaert on your screen now had the misfortune to puncture his front tyre, and by the time he chased his way back, the man up on the front there in the rainbow jersey had flown. There was no way they could catch him back, and Bogaert must be one of the most disappointed men in the whole of the season. Beautiful autumn colours again in the mountains. We're coming down out towards the plain in Bergamo, the plain of Lombardy. And thank goodness we've got some reasonable weather for it, because in the past this race has been marred by low cloud and dismal conditions. In fact, the Milan Cycle Show, which is usually held round about November, in fact, I think they moved it back this year. But anyway, it used to be held in November. I used to go to it quite often. We had problems flying in out of Milan by the time we came to November, because you get this sort of foggy, low-lying area in Lombardy, because it's you know, one of the busiest parts in Italy, really, because you've got the green Po plain, and then we've got all the water coming down from the rivers, the Adda, the Maggiore, the Como and Garda, and these great lakes are up on the north of the plain, and the dampness comes out of it, and then you've got the big industrial city like Milan, and the fog soon comes along. But it's quite a nice part of the world, because around about just when we come down towards Bergamo, around about the nice dairy farming and processing. In fact, the district 2 just away from here as well, they grow a lot of rice as well. So we'll be going into a very old town, Bergamo, one of the principal towns of Lombardy, to finish the race this year, and these two may or may not be able to get there. Just 1 minute and 30 seconds still, round about the hovering 120, 130, 140, keep coming up and back and going back, and I fear that unless they can get it to maybe over 2 minutes on this climb, then they might find themselves being swallowed up by a very determined group coming up. Oh, it's 110. 110. It is coming down now. 1 minute and 10 seconds for these two riders, as Kamerzin takes over the chase on the front. What an amazing thing it is when a man gets to win a championship. He suddenly seems to have wings and is prepared to ride himself into a frazzle. And Kamerzin really is coming into a very good period right now. Let's hope he can hold it into next year, because it's often been, as I mentioned last Sunday, a kiss of death to wear the rainbow jersey and to find yourself struggling with form and accident and sponsors pack up and all sorts of things. But Kamerzin has done quite well so far. He rode in the Milan-Turin just during the middle of this week, when Nicky Ebersol won that one, and Kamerzin was in second spot. So he's already had a second place wearing that jersey. Can he win today? But I think there's a determined attack from the chasing threesome here might make life a bit difficult. Belli seems to have recovered and got back in this little group. In fact, no, he's not. It's Bartoli still. So Belli's gone straight out of that chasing group, leaving just these two on the front. And there we are. If you could turn yourself sideways 45 degrees, you'll see that's the profile. I've never seen a profile put that way before, but, well, that's, I suppose, a nice Italian way of doing things. And that's the profile. And down at the bottom of the screen, that final blip is the final climb of the day. And then off the top of that one and thundering down into Bergamo, a very good run in, which means a fast-moving chase group could probably pull back these two riders on your screen. Well, if Kamerzin can win this one, or Bogaert can win this one, looking back over the results, Pascal Richard was the last Swiss rider to win it in 1993. Tony Rominger, who'd been working for us on Eurosport, he won it in 1992. And Top Rominger won it in 1989. I'm looking back for the Dutch winner before that. Yes, the last one was Henny Kuiper in 1981. Henny was one of the key driving forces behind the, whoops, steady lads, behind the World Championships last week. Henny Kuiper won in 1981. So for Bogaert here, a chance to join up with the great Henny Kuiper, the last Dutch winner way back in 1981. We've got a long way to go back. We've only ever had one British winner, by the way. Tommy Simpson won this race in 1965. So the English-speaking riders and the exception of Tommy Simpson, the only one from Great Britain, but we've had Sean Kelly won it in 83, 85 and 91. So that gives you some idea that it's a hard man's course, because people like Sean Kelly have been known to enjoy the damp conditions and a long season and triumph when the going gets really tough. The winner last year, Laurent Jalabert, not riding the show, as you know. He's been a bit sort of disillusioned mentally and physically at the end of the season. He has, by the way, written to the UCI to explain the comments he made during the Tour of Spain when he referred to little Hitlers and bloodsuckers, so vampires, that was it. He was rather sort of derogatory, but he explained and he apologised, and so I think he just had a slap on the wrist and not a suspension, which he might have had. Well, Jalabert won this race last year ahead of Lanfranchi and Casa Grande, but now those two are riding. And in 1996, André Taffy, who's in the chase group at the moment, who won ahead of Jekka and Axel Merckx. So that's a recent update on this great classic race, which dates back to 1905. This is one of the oldest standing classics on the books, and this is the 92nd version of the Giro di Lombardy. Well, his belly trying to hang on to that group, but he's not having any success, and struggling still at the back for Lotti, living dangerously. There he is. He's always been just there or thereabouts, and he needs to get right in the tail end of this one, otherwise he's going to find himself out of it. 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, so about 10 of them left in this little group. We've got, four, five, six down the road, so that's 16. We've just got two or three have been tailed off now, the original 19-man group that went away after about 130 kilometres of racing. And Camazin and Bogart are still working extremely well together here. Well, we saw Claudio Chiappucci at the start of our programme when we recorded the proceedings in Varese this morning. Claudio Chiappucci, the question mark is whether he will actually go on next year. He's now aged 35, he's 13 years a professional. The rumour is that he might go to this Mobile Veta team that seems to have come out with a big checkbook, because they've signed Stefano Faustini from Vini Calderola, as well as Pascal Richard. Signed Mirko Guoldi from Polti. Now, he's tremendously quick rider indeed, and been very successful in the, as you saw in the Tour of Spain this year. They've also signing Massimo Strazza, and Rodolfo Massi might be joining Claudio Chiappucci. We don't know much about that yet, but we shall wait and see with bated breath to see if the if that's going to be so. Well, it was, of course, did quite a good ride in the Paris Tour the other week. I'm sorry, one of my viewers wrote in a rather abrasive letter and said I didn't pick up the third man. Certainly, I could see who it was, and I don't suppose many people recognise him anyway, because with his blue top to his jersey, the national champion. But if I didn't, I'm sorry. I was so over the moon about the, I don't like the cliché, but when Jackie Duron got that one. But I wonder how many other people, or the commentator, would have spotted the fact that after 42 years, he finally won that one, and that the last man to win the Paris Tour was actually sat in the car behind, two-thirds hidden by the by the chap standing in front of him. Well, these two look like they're going to stay away at the moment. I hope I can pick out the finish again for him and try and get you a third place man. I do the best I can. Not always if I get excited, because I did get carried away last week when we did, well, 2 weeks ago when we did the Paris Tour. And coming off the top of this drop now, I think there's a fair chance for, if those chase get together, they might pull back these two leaders. Let's go back to Albert Bouvet, who was the last Frenchman to win that Paris Tour. Certainly, I think he was as pleased as anybody that his record went after 42 years. And somebody said to me after that, I think the break went, or Durand went with 42 kilometres to go. And I think at one time their lead was 42 seconds, or something stupid. Everybody in the press were trying to drag out the 42 significantly between Jackie Durand's win and the last victory by the Frenchman. Here we go. Oh, but he's gone off the front now, but I tell you, really, he's starting to steam along here. He's very determined that it doesn't really have to ride this hard, but I think he's still smarting over his bronze medal in the World Championships. And, of course, Lance Armstrong must also be smarting with his succession of fourth places. Now, I understand he's been speaking to Johnny Veltz on the radio phone just a short while ago before we came on air that Lance is off on holiday going back to America. And I wonder what happens to the cat Chemo and the little dog as well, because you can't transfer them backwards and forwards because of the troubles with the quarantine arrangements. But no doubt we'll looked after. Back then, still with our two leaders. it really is going to be difficult to stay away, as you can see, because when they're going down the zigzag, you just look over the side, provided you don't, if you're not afraid of heights, and you can see them down the road. You can see with Pascal Richard just going away now after Bartoli, who's really opened up an enormous gap on the Siddle group. Well, so on the way down here, they have fragmented quite a bit, and it looks as if, unless they can get together, those two chaps in front who are working a lot better than this chase group might well be able to stay away. Well, the big wide swinging bends are suiting a little twosome up in front at the moment, as Kamerzin follows Bogart round. And again, Bogart's a man who loves nasty conditions. I remember when he won that stage in the Tour of France into Aix-les-Bains when the heavens opened and we had a monsoon period. So both these two don't seem to be a bit frazzled by the fact that it's not all that warm. The roads are a bit damp and wet. And both of them, I think, revelling here in conditions that make it very hard indeed. In fact, news is behind in the chase group. Overall, there's probably less than 50 riders left in the field out of the 195 that started. But who's going to win this one? We're back with our two leaders, heading into, you can see, the falling leaves, and this, the last big classic of the season, the final of the World Cup round that we're bringing you on Eurosport. We've brought all bar two of the World Cup rounds to you. We've brought you the Tour of Spain, the Tour of France, the Tour of Italy in reverse order, Tour of Switzerland, Tour of Romandy, and so on. So we've been bringing all the best in bike racing we can lay our hands on during the season, and it looks like next year we've got similar plans coming up as well. If you're interested in the way that cycling has evolved, you want a lot more facts and figures, there's a CD-ROM actually coming out that we advertised in the cycling press, and we were given information of it during the World Championships, and it's got something like 10,000 rider profiles, 110,000 results, a quiz, thousands of pictures, 20 videos, over 100 mountain facts and graphs, and this CD-ROM, in fact, I've had a sample sent to me by Richard Olchin from Sport and Publicity, and I think you'll find it's going to be advertised in cycling, and it's going to be around about, I don't know, 20, 25 quid, but anybody who's got I think you have to put it on one of these Windows 95, but if you want to sort of play around during the winter and get yourself a copy of this, watch the cycling press, it'll certainly be advertised in there, and I'm looking forward to playing around with my copy of it too as well. Hope we don't get too dug into too many details. 110,000 results, mind-boggling, isn't it? And 10,000 profiles. Well, that's there for you people who are interested in all the intimate facts and figures. And thanks to all this I've been receiving as we're watching these two riders now, with Bartoli trying to close the gap and come up to them. Certainly that Bartoli being very active going into third space at the moment, and the gap has come down inside a minute now to our two leaders who are still out there. And if you've switched on and picked up our coverage of the Giro de Lombardy, it's Oscar Kamerzin in the World Champions Rainbow jersey, there behind the man in the Dutch National Championship jersey, Michael Berger. In fact, Michael Berger has been twice the Dutch champion, and this year he had a fifth overall in the Tour de France. He was fourth in the Amstel Gold, fifth in the Liège Bastogne Liège, and fourth in Frankfurt. So he's always been there or thereabouts, except when he came for the National Championship of Holland, when he snaffled that for the second time. Very determined rider being urged on here by, I think it's Theo de Ruy in the team car, and looks, I think, for Rabobank people to get a big end-of-season victory. But can he dislodge the man up in front, Oscar Kamerzin? There are 48 seconds it is now. Well, I've heard over the headphones it was coming down less than a minute and was getting close to that 46, 48, but now it's down to 46 seconds as they come through here. So getting down the flat part and getting in towards the end of the finish into Bergamo. I mentioned earlier on about the letters we've been having into Eurosport. It's been impossible this year to keep up with them all. I'm sorry if I haven't been able to reply to them on air, but I'll try and do the best in the winter break. We're going to be back on with the sixth day from Munich on November the 6th, I think it is, 6th and 7th. I think we do Friday night and Saturday night, and then we come back on the following Tuesday for the last night as Bartoli here starts to come at them. Because later on tonight we're going to bring you the action from Bercy, the track meeting there, the Open de Nation, where Britain's Rob Hales is riding in a European squad. But Bartoli determined to get up there now and try and get with those two. And I think if they do get together, this man has got a sizzling sprint and could probably run out victor of the Giro de Lombardy. That would be an absolute wonderful close to his season to come through and get the victory if he can do at the end of it all. Keep your fingers crossed at Bartoli. I was talking about the letters. I'll just pick one out here from Bicester, by the way, and it came from John and Sue Baldwin, and she was saying in a letter, Sue, that her husband's an ex-cyclist, now disabled, and so he watched every day of the Tour de France, and they appreciate what had been going on. So thanks for this thing. Just illustrating there are people who, for one reason or other, are laid up at home, sick, unable to go to work, and they've been stuck listening to me on Eurosport and what we've been putting out. Thanks for the nice letters that you sent to us. And an amazing letter I had too as well, which said, "We'd love all things possible. This letter's been sent to you for good luck. The original in New York." It's one of these sort of round-robin pyramid-type letters. They don't ask for any money. They say that I have to send it on, and if I do send it on, good luck will come to me. Well, unfortunately, it happened whilst I was out on the Tour of Spain, and I never got back to send it within 10 days. Otherwise, I got 10 days of bad luck. And I think they must have been right. The gap's down to 48 seconds because in the World Championships, when this letter arrived, and I couldn't send it on to the next 20 people. That's all I have to do. My car broke down twice. And what else had go wrong? Many things have gone wrong in the last few days. So it says, do not make the mistake and not send it on. Well, I didn't send it on. Sorry about that. It's unsigned. It's one of these sort of pyramid letters. Doesn't ask for any money. But no wonder I've had some bad luck. Sorry about that too. Well, get back to the race now, David. I will do that. And just thank you all, good people. In due time, I'll try and reply to the questions you asked me, because they've been jolly good, very interesting questions. And little comments too. I mentioned that about Tommy Simpson earlier on in this programme, about the success he had in the Tour of Lombardy. And during the commentary we did at the Bordeaux track meeting, I mentioned that Tommy Simpson, I thought, won the Bordeaux Paris. And in fact, he did. I had somebody write here and gave me very blow-by-blow exactly what Tommy did and when he broke away and how he went on. And the distance was 356 miles, 569 kilometres, and he did the last 150 miles or so behind the Derny. And so that was... 1963 it was, when he beat Peter Poss and Joe DeRue, who had won in the previous year. They'd been a group that stayed together until the final Valley of Chevreuse, where Simpson mounted his main attack on the Côte de Doudon, finished over 5 minutes ahead the second man, Rietnester. 357 miles in 15 hours and 43 minutes. So thanks for that, Mike Burns of the Coventry Olympic, and also a letter from Mr. Sidgwick up in Almsby, Middlesbrough in Cleveland. Right, back to the race then, is it regrouping itself here? I'd like to know, and I'd like to read out some of your letters, and I hope you'll live with me when I stare from the straight and narrow, because it's nice to know that you good people are out there prepared to get involved as well. This is our group now. You see Bartoli's gone back and been caught by Pascal Richard, and also catching him up at the moment too, Gilberto Simoni. That's Simoni there in the blue for Cantinatolo, and with the blue pants and the special World Cup white jersey, Bartoli, and a man who's won this race in the past, Pascal Richard, just still driving hard. These are the three chasers down the road. We've still got those two men away, the gap then hovering around about 40 to 45 seconds. And here they are, sorry about that, breaking up yet again. Let's see where the major chase group is, because there's a fair-sized bunch behind that three-man group. There they are. That's the three-man group. And in that chase group at the moment is Marco Serpellini. Not these three here, but the group behind that. And he's coming to this race in good form too, because he won the Tour of Piedmont, which finished in the Velodrome Fausto Coppi. Marco Serpellini, during this last week, by the way, when he beat Nardello and Collage. And Marco Serpellini used to be the junior world champion in 1991, so you can see how when the world championship we covered this year for it, the junior championship, when Mark Scanlon won that, could probably come on to be like a Marco Serpellini, who won that race, the Tour of Piedmont, during the week. He was the ninth and best Italian in the Tour of Italy with Marco Serpellini, and he finished ahead of Nardello and Collage in this Tour of Piedmont during the week. Interesting too, Marco's have four brothers, or one of four brothers. They're all called Marino, Marcello, Mario, and he's Marco. Four M's, so must be something in it for Mr. Serpellini's father. He's going to have to Lamprey, by the way, next season, Marco Serpellini. Lots of people moving from team to team. I'll try and fill you in with some of the team movements as we go on toward the finish. But this is getting very close indeed now, as riders one by one come hammering up from the chase group to join those three to try and catch our two leaders. Mm-hmm. There we are, inside the last 7 kilometres of this race. Two stalwarts here on your screen still staying away from that chase group, but the gap has not really been big enough for them to let go at all. But they managed to push it back out again to just over a minute, and at one time it was down to 42 seconds, but they managed to go that bit quicker running in toward the finish in Bergamo, and it looks like it could be down to these two then if they just hang on in these final 7 kilometres. So right behind, but the gap's now closing up all the time, and we understand there's only about 40-odd riders left in the race now. It's been such a hard day, and I wonder who's going to come in last. Amongst those, of course, out there, the Gregarios, and that's the name of this club which meets every week at the Alpine Bushy near Watford in Hertfordshire and go for a little ride round. I understand they're watching the final Tour of Lombardy on, or final coverage of the big World Cup Tour of Lombardy on television today, getting stuck into their into espressos and pizzas and perhaps a little drop of the old vino. And thanks, chaps, for what you said to me. And it's the Super Club Ciclista from the Italian domestics, the Gregarios, who've done their work now. Most of them are on the way back down into the finish, having had another hard day in the saddle. Today, then, covering this 253 kilometres, that's 158 miles. You think of that. They start at 10:30 in the morning, and they're going to be racing for over 6 hours at the end of it all, on top of a couple of small races during this week. And, of course, last Sunday, again, nearly 160 miles for these riders you see on your screen in the World Championship. It's mind-boggling, isn't it? I know many people who watch Eurosport's coverage of cycling who are not cyclists just marvel at the tremendous athletic ability of the people that you're watching on your screen. And yes, you have to be fairly hard to do it, and the man at the back of the Tucson group here, Oscar Kamsin, interesting enough, he is the son of a farmer, and when he went back after the Championship of the World on Sunday, he's raced just once since then, he said he hasn't changed his life. He hasn't been to bed in the World Championship jersey. He's just trying to relax. He has to answer questions from the journalists. But interesting enough, as I say, son of a farmer, and all the four previous winners, Schott, Kint and Raas of the World Championship at the Valkenburg circuit, were all sons of farmers. And the man who's won this race three times, Sean Kelly, also the son of a farmer. So when he gets to the back end of the year and he gets these really tough races, then that sort of background which comes from working on the land comes good. Now, not everybody has to be a farmer's son to be a successful cyclist. We've had university students, we've had people who've come from families with lots of money who've become jolly good racing cyclists over the years. But it does seem that if you've been brought up with the hard background that farmers have to have, working 7 days a week, all hours that God sends, it certainly comes down to the genes, and you can put up with this sort of racing that they're having to put up with now. A terrible rough run in towards the finish. There's cobbles lying ahead of them as they come into the outskirts and into Bergamo for the end of this season's racing. I hope you've enjoyed all we've given you on Eurosport, and I've looked at the programme for next year, and it looks like we're going to be doing all the same races you've seen this year, and I'm looking forward to next year as you are too. Just a little quiet break for us, just this track meeting over the weekend now, then the Munich 6 day, and then we're back in action in the spring of next year. Right, they're all regrouping here. Bartoli's been caught by Pascal Richard in the red pants there. Bartoli on the front. And just behind, we have Gilberto Simoni, that's the man from Cantina Tolo, and back up over the front. And Puccini's the other man who's in there as well for the Rossmeri team. Coming up now on this run in towards the finish of the race, in through the gate. We're just going in through the gate of Porta Garibaldi, and then we'll be going through the Porta San Lorenzo, over the Porta Pantano, and then through the final one, the Porta Agostino, with 2.3 kilometres to go. And you can see the state of this road here and the climbs they've got. It's buffeting these bike riders, and they've been in the saddle now for nearly 6 hours, and look at the road they've got to ride over. And this is again after last week when they were riding on those disgusting conditions in Holland in the World Championship. You have to admire their strength, their stamina, their determination, and the gutsy performances we bring you here, the colour of cycle racing, all the joy when you win, the pain of when you lose. But you have to go with these lads and say, come on, just stay away. I think these two deserve to fight out first and second. But Bartoli ought to be with them probably, because these have entertained us towards the back end this evening. And who's going to go first? It's on the left-hand side. Bogart starts to go. Bogart then off. Well, we've had only so far three in all the years of this 92nd tour. Only three winners from Holland. Only three winners from Switzerland. Is it going to be Kamsin to make a fourth? He goes now through the crowd. Well, they'll be looking for Italian victory, I think, but they don't mind if Kamsin gets it, because he rides for the Italian Mapei squad. I think he's off next year. He's getting transferred out of the Mappe team to, I'm not sure it's Lamprey squad he's going to, but certainly he's out, but they don't mind. Mappe really have had so much publicity out of this man at the back of the season. And amazingly, he hadn't won a race until last Sunday. And what if he can get this one too on your CV for a 1998 season? If you opened up the CV with a win in the World Championship and you finish it with a win in the Giro de Lombardy, and those are the only two races you won, my goodness, what a CV to have. But Bogart too, he must surely fight his way back. He's also had been, well, always there, fourth and fifth place, except for his big success in the Dutch Championships. And this may not be a day when he's going to get that victory, but he could come back. He's really gritting his teeth now. Now, this is much better. It's much smoother now. It's leveled off a bit. Perhaps if Bogart's got anything left in his legs, he can come at Kamerzin now. Kamerzin was, I think at one time a pursuit champion as well. This lad then was born in Lucerne in Switzerland. And this year, I'll say that was his first victory, but he was fourth in the Tour of Italy, which showed that he got the strength. And now this comes a chase group, but they're over a minute down now, so they're only really riding into third place. Bartoli has prized himself forward, ahead of the rider from the Rasmeri Chips, that's Puccini. So Puccini sitting in second spot, Richard at the back, and at the front, doing the sort of same thing he did in the World Championship on Sunday. Oscar Kamerzin riding away at the front. Beautiful old city here of Bergamo. But they've got two parts, an upper town, a lower town. The lower town and the upper town being split, one being the new part, one being the old part. And you could get some lovely views of here. It goes way back to the 12,000 BC when the Ligurians occupied the upper part of the town. The Gauls seized it in AD 550, and then the Romans came here and took it over in 196 BC. It's a very old place indeed, destroyed by the barbarians, but now built back again. And who's going to take the victory in this beautiful old town? Kamerzin at the moment is just hammering along here. Look at his number, 113. Well, 13 would be unlucky for some, but for this man, it looks like it might be lucky for him. Perhaps not superstitious, Kamerzin, with a 13. We shall see. Oh, steady boy. Well, it's very much a sort of chase, really, for ones and twos. And there he goes. And he's opened quite a little gap now because it looks like Bogart's dropping back. One man against the other. It's not going to be a finished sprint if they keep this one up, because they're just going to trail each other in. Have they got anything left at all? Bogart, has he got anything left to catch up this man, Kamerzin, hammering along here? Well, he first started work as a postman before he became a professional bike rider. And he stamped his authority on this, but no, get off. One kilometre to go, there it is. Well, surely he's going to get it now. He's come over the roughest part of this course. And if Switzerland get this one, he's following in the wheel marks of the great Tony Rominger. Rominger, who was a tremendous tour rider. The one thing he never got, Rominger, was a World Championship jersey on his shoulders. But this Swiss rider here has got that. It looks like he's going to go in the record books too, as did Tony Rominger, as the winner of the Tour of Lombardy. It's going to be the fourth Swiss rider to get the Tour of Lombardy success. Coming in here after Rominger, Pascal Richard. Rominger got it twice. Pascal Richard got it as well. And now it looks like he's got enough steam up to come through and get this one. Way back in 1949, Fausto Coppi got it. Ferdi Kubler was in second spot for Switzerland those days, so they've always been there or thereabouts. But this man has really triumphed at the back end of the season. He's just making sure that he gets himself organised. And still, Bogart is riding himself into oblivion here to try and close that gap down. It's not that easy yet, Oscar. Be careful as he swings round here. Coming in then, in towards Centurione. This little short, sharp finishing straight, he should be able to make it now into the Piazza Matteotti, where the crowd is going to applaud the gutsy performance of the world champion. It's not often you get a world champion come straight out the following week and smash people in a big major classic like this one. But he's done just that. Oscar Kamerzin takes the 92nd Giro Lombardy. And behind, disappointment yet again for Bogart, who punctured last week in the World Championships. He's now going to settle for second spot today. And who's going to get third for that little group that's chasing down the road? What a way to end the season. And here they come. Well, Bartoli surely has the most sizzling sprint of these three. Excuse me, gentlemen, can we see the finish? Help! Good, there we are. Now then, we've got in here Pascal Richard and Bartoli. Probably Bartoli the best sprinter. Richard on the left, Bartoli in the centre, and Puccini, the Rosmeri rider, on the right-hand side. And Richard saying, come on, Bartoli, it's your turn to go through. And while they're messing around, these two, he's taken off then. And Puccini's gone up and said, well, you two can sort out your difference. I'm going to leave you two. And, well, Bartoli riding in here, he may only take fourth spot, but he's going to take the World Cup as the rider from the Rosmeri Chips gives them a lesson, I think, by leaving them around this bend. Sure, they can't catch him now. Whoops, he swung too far, he nearly cooked that one up, they've all come swinging back round again, and Bartoli now is launching himself into orbit, but Puccini grits his teeth and just makes it to the line then, ahead of Bartoli with Pascal Richard into fifth spot. Well, there we are looking back across the town and coming in, still lots of riders in those chase groups at the moment, but the next lot, we understand, are well over 3 minutes down. This is Simone coming in now, but the next group going to be well over 3 minutes back behind Simone from Cantina Tolla. He was up there with that leading group at one point and then drifted off the back when the action really started. So he's now coming into sixth spot and the chase group behind. As we look back at the slow motion of Oscar Camerzin. And that's Oscar Camerzin, our victor today. Well, Bergamo, this beautiful old town then. In the background, the Palazzo della Regione and the Duomo and the Celioni Chapel are coming up to celebrate, and the bells certainly will ring, I think, back in Switzerland. Oh, the bells, after the World Championship last Sunday, they came along, these Swiss supporters, being there to see Camerzin take his world medal, and had these great cowbells, they marched past our commentary point. Jong, 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 you've never heard anything like it. They really went barmy, the Swiss supporters did, with the bells. I'm sure the bells will be going yet again for Camerzin, particularly the farmer's son, he'll be out there in the fields, and the bells will be ringing, and he's now taken this great classic race at the end of the season, the Giro de Lombardy. On the right-hand side in the yellow jersey, the man who was third, and that was Felice Puttuni, and on the left-hand side, the Rabobank rider and national champion of Holland, Michael Bogart, into second spot. Well, that's it then, the Giro de Lombardy being won in convincing style by the new world champion. Looking forward to seeing him in action next year. Let's hope the success doesn't go to his head. So many of the world champions have had a very poor year after they've taken the rainbow jersey. But I think somehow this man is a sensible fellow, and he'll be looked after well by his team and his countrymen too. So I look forward to seeing him ride next year. And to all the chaps who have entertained us this year, and those who are going to retire at the end of the season, I know that you would wish them luck, particularly Gianni Bugno, who is retiring at the... I think he's got one more race to go. And for me, well, I've got a bit of dry throat, and I rather like that shanty. It says, I feel no pain, dear mother, now, but oh, I am so dry. Oh, take me to a brewery and leave me there to die. It's been a very long season, a thirsty one. Can I have some of that to drink? Well, well done, young man. And I'm very pleased to see that some of the old guards, they disappear. We'll be looking at these riders who have triumphed over adversity. And we've had a very tumultuous year with all the problems that have been going on. But I think it bodes well for next year, with a lot of new blood coming up onto the rostrum and surprising many people by the success. And there it is then, the trophy. And I think we should be seeing, I hope, up on the rostrum, the man who's won the World Cup overall, because Mikhail Bartoli has won the World Cup. And a man, let's hope he comes up and just give a quick rundown on Bartoli before he joins these three. If he doesn't, then let me tell you what he's done this year. Bartoli, who has taken the World Cup in convincing style, won the Liège-Bastogne-Liège early on this season. He won the Grand Prix Swiss. He was second in the Hugh Classic, third in the Amstel Gold. So we get a bit of background music, we can see the breakaway group here of the threesome, which turned into twosome, which got our first and second place, and we wait then for Bartoli to come up to receive his award. I think this might have been Bates de Berg who crashed out of this one, by the way, because we certainly got a rider from the casino team who got back on his bike and got back in that chase group. And we look then at what was happening earlier on today, and Bartoli, you see, just going away from Taffy, who won this race a couple of years ago, to get up there, but he couldn't get himself on the top three places. Trying to Well, there we are then. And yes, we have got Bartoli up there, the man who's convincingly won the World Cup again this year, the second time he's won it. And last year he had similar success. He won the Les Bastonnais last year. He's won it again this year. That's an amazing double to have. And he won the Henniger term last year. And he fifth in Milan San Remo. Had a tremendous season last year. He got the World Cup. He's done it again this year, Bartoli. A disappointment, I think, in the World Championships that he only finished in the bronze medal position. But certainly to win the World Cup is great. Very few people have ambitions like he'd got at the start this year. He rode with determination all the way through to get that World Cup. He only missed out in one race, not scoring any points, was the Paris-Roubaix. So for World Cup victor Bartoli, next year beckons. I wonder if he can get a triple. Well, you can watch it on Eurosport next year. We'll be covering the World Cups then. Until then, myself, David Duffield, look forward. Bye-bye.